Thank you to everyone joining us here on campus and to those watching online. We appreciate you taking the time, especially in this busy part of the Cornell year, to join us. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Raj Ruskini. I'm the president of the Cornell Republicans. Our organization has stood on this campus for 143 years, proudly promoting the values that made this country great. Today, we serve as one of the only unapologetically conservative groups on a campus where most students identify with the political left. In an environment where finding conservative students is such a rarity, many ask me why we do what we do. What is the point of fighting a tidal wave as one small drop in the ocean? The answer is simple. We believe that our values and perspectives are worth fighting for, and that they must be heard. We believe that the students coming out of Cornell, the doctors, scientists, engineers, politicians, and yes, even hotel administrators of tomorrow, must hear the perspectives and opinions held by millions of their fellow countrymen, especially the views with which they disagree. Cornell fails if it graduates students who cannot suffer the existence of opposition. So many of our classmates are distraught at the mere idea of sharing a zip code with people with whom they disagree. This is not the behavior of a healthy country. We will not last long as one nation if we cannot learn to live with each other. Before I introduce tonight's speaker, I want to thank Young America's Foundation and the immensely generous donors of the Cornell Republicans. Without their support, events like these would not be possible. Without further ado, tonight I have the high honor and distinct pleasure of introducing Mr. Michael Knowles of the Daily Wire. Mr. Knowles is a best-selling author, though snubbed by the New York Times, has published 2 books and written 1, is a graduate of Yale University, and of course is the host of the Michael Knowles Show. Mr. Knowles has received numerous accolades and distinctions, including being named as a 2020 Lincoln Fellow at the Claremont Institute and recently winning the Conservative Mind Award from the American Conservative Magazine. Among his more libelous accolades, Mr. Knowles has been accused of being a genocidal maniac by the national press. Mr. Knowles visits Cornell at a time of uncertainty for our campus and for all of higher education. We struggle with elements of our national identity, long thought fundamental. We cannot agree on what free expression is, what ideas deserve to be litigated and what ideas do not. Worse, in recent weeks, our campus has been the site of increased tensions over the conflict in the Middle East. To address all of these topics and so much more, please join me in welcoming Mr. Michael Knowles.
Thank you very much. It's so great to be here. Please pardon that I'm a little bit wet. I forgot that it's kind of cold and rainy in New York, though the cold and the rain have been helpful in that I wasn't greeted by masses of shrieking protesters. So it seems to have kept Antifa at bay. It's a real pleasure to be here. I want to thank Cornell for inviting me. I want to thank YAF, as always, for hosting. I'd like to thank the Logan family for supporting this lecture series. And I would, in fact, like to thank my critics for being relatively well-behaved tonight. I understand there was a trans solidarity protest or something like that outside of this venue, led by a gal who went viral for complaining about working at Starbucks, and a gal who I actually have a great deal of sympathy for, because it's kind of tough to work these jobs and Republicans are not nearly pro-worker enough. So anyway, if she's outside, it would be great for her to come in and we can chat. I would love a Starbucks also. I'm, you know, a little tired after my flight in. But otherwise, I'd like to thank them for being well-behaved. Last semester, I'm sorry to say, the protesters were not so well-behaved. Some of my critics, when I showed up to the University of Pittsburgh, tried to blow me up, which I find very impolite. I think that was very wrong of them to do. A couple of Antifa operatives showed up to this appearance I had at Pitt, and they burned me in effigy, and they set the street on fire, and then they threw an explosive at the venue when I started to walk on stage, which was not a very warm welcome. In fact, it was a very warm welcome. It was a burning hot welcome, but it was not very nice. So when I received this invitation to Cornell, I feared I might face a similar scene. Cornell, after all, is one of the early hubs of leftist violence on campus. The takeover of Willard Straight Hall in 1969 is probably the most infamous such incident in American history. I'm sure that everybody in this room knows about the takeover. For those of you at home who are not familiar with it, on April 19th, 1969, rifle-wielding black student radicals stormed and occupied the Willard Straight Hall at this very university, evicting parents who had been visiting their children for the weekend and inflicting maximum reputational damage on Cornell. Why did the students take over the hall? According to the armed occupiers, the takeover was a response to reports of a burning cross at the Wary Student Center the night before. White supremacists threatened black students, and so the black students threatened back. But it turns out that the whole thing was fake news. It was Jussie Smollett, the prequel. It was all just a big hoax. Ithaca police never managed to track down those elusive cross burners, and they suspected that the Afro-American Society members themselves set the blaze in order to justify further protests. This thesis was not just the result of knee-jerk prejudice. One member of the Afro-American Society later seemed to confirm it. Stephen Goodwin, a Cornell student who was the treasurer of the Afro-American Society, called the cross burning, quote, a setup. The society had contrived the hoax, according to Goodwin, quote, to bring more media and more attention to the whole thing. Now such hoaxes have become commonplace. What did the radicals want? The chief demand was the creation of an Africana Studies department. Africana Studies, like virtually all of the studies departments, is a pseudo-academic discipline that replaces liberal education aimed at discovering truth and disciplining the will and intellect with training in political activism that undermines a student's education by encouraging a radical skepticism that denies the very possibility of discerning truth, thereby degrading politics from a rational endeavor into a battle of irrational will. Before the student paper calls me racist, I'm sure that the pens are already aflutter with that accusation, please rest assured that I feel the same way about all of the critical studies departments, whether we're talking about queer studies or women's studies or even American studies. The only difference between American studies and all of the other critical studies departments is that American studies is the only studies that hates its own subject. So queer studies loves queers. Women's studies loves women, at least as long as they're feminist. Black studies loves black people. Only American studies hates its subject, which is America. But I digress. I could go on about that all day long. The great economist and social writer Thomas Sowell, who is 93 years young and still sharp as a tack, Thomas Sowell, one of the great living American intellects, he took an even tougher view of the motives for the takeover. Thomas Sowell, who had joined the Cornell faculty 4 years prior, right before the Willard Straight Hall takeover, he observed that the white president of Cornell had, quote, sought to increase minority student enrollment and to do so by admitting students who would not meet the existing academic standards at Cornell, which meant that, in Sowell's words, quote, the emphasis was on getting militant ghetto kids, some of whom turned out to be hoodlums who terrorized other black students, in addition to provoking a racial backlash among whites. This is, of course, exactly what happened. Had Cornell hired faculty and accepted students without lowering standards, had the newly recruited black population of Cornell been made up entirely of Thomas Sowells, there never would have been a Willard Straight Hall takeover, and there never would have been a creation of this pseudo-academic department, and the students would have been required, as they previously had been, to get an education if they wanted to graduate. The black activism was the most visible, but the same pattern applied to all of the other supposedly aggrieved groups that demanded special treatment, thereby lowering the standards for everyone and producing now multiple generations of highly credentialed, extraordinarily ignorant radicals. Today, sadly, but not surprisingly, some of the Cornell administration seems to look back on the school's greatest shame with indifference at best, and more often with pride. The official Cornell website reads, quote, Within Cornell, the takeover has come to be seen as an event that gave birth to enormous social governance and ideological change. It's a very diplomatic way of putting it. A headline linked on the website reads, quote, "A campus takeover that symbolized an era of change," with AK-47s evicting parents from their rooms. Yes, the change of the American university, not just Cornell, not just the Ivy League, virtually all of them, from institutions of higher learning for producing educated citizens into radical indoctrination factories for producing ignorant activists. The new perspective is no coincidence. The radicals won the campus fights of the 1960s, and they now run those universities as tenured radicals, to borrow a phrase from Roger Kimball. Today, according to a number of surveys, some 24% of college professors in the social sciences call themselves radical. 21% call themselves activists. 18% call themselves Marxists. The ratio of liberal to conservative professors, according to another survey, is 8-1 in poli-sci. That's pretty bad. It's 17-1 in history departments. It's 44-1 in sociology. It's 48-1 in English. And it's 108-0 in race and gender studies. I don't really know how that one works. I was not a math major, but I suppose I would even think it might be higher. As my friend Chris Rufo pointed out in his excellent new book, America's Cultural Revolution, the most prominent leaders of the radical student movements of the 1960s, I'm thinking of Bill Ayers, the leader of the Weather Underground, which was a terror group for those of you too young to remember, Angela Davis, a communist terrorist who plotted an attack, a kidnapping that left four people dead, including a judge. Those people and many others ended up with cushy university sinecures. Meanwhile, the radicalism spreads. Yet again, on Cornell's campus, which just last week saw the arrest of a student who was threatening to kill all the Jews. Just my luck. I survive Antifa at the University of Pittsburgh, and I end up at Cornell with Hamas. What are the odds? All the way up in Ithaca. I didn't think they could get this far up. The student behind these threats, Patrick Dye, Dye is a little on the nose if you ask me, apparently posted notes to an online discussion site threatening to, quote, "shoot up 104 West, which seems to be the kosher dining hall, as well as to stab and slit the throat of any Jewish man he found on campus, and to do all sorts of terrible things to Jewish women that he found on campus, and to behead Jewish babies before finally threatening to, quote, "bring an assault rifle to campus and shoot all you pig Jews." This is not good. The liberal media did not quite know how to react to the threats because the threats did not fit the pre-written narrative. If a student threatens Jews on campus, that student is supposed to be a skinhead neo-Nazi. He's ideally going to be one who voted for Donald Trump. Best of all, he would be one who listens to a lot of conservative media, all of whom can then be vilified after the incident. Short of that, the student should at least be Arab. Arabs were considered white, according to official government documents, for a lot of American history. So in that way, the media could twist it into the guy being like sort of white, kind of like a George Zimmerman after the killing of Trayvon Martin. George Zimmerman was reported. The guy is as Hispanic as they come. They said, he's a white Hispanic. You know, he leans white anyway. He identifies as white. He's transracial, I don't know. Then the liberal media could at least blame white people for perpetuating the Islamophobia that drove this hypothetically Muslim student to threaten to kill all the Jews. All that would have worked fine for the narrative. But when the threats come from a random Asian guy, the liberal elite has no idea what to do. Even conservatives might be a little confused over how to react. After all, conservatives have spent the past 7 or 8 years at least describing ourselves as the defenders of free speech. Free speech absolutists, some have called themselves. Not me, but some of them have done that. But of course, threats have never been protected speech in this country. or in any sensible country for that matter. Neither has libel, neither has obscenity. For much of American history, we had laws against blasphemy in many parts of this country. No one ever considered that to be some grave violation of the First Amendment. The principles of free speech, even John Locke, who is one of the most articulate defenders of free speech ever, he is the father of liberalism, even Locke argued in the letter concerning toleration that atheists should not be afforded free speech or really any rights at all. All societies have a right to standards. And in any case, all societies have standards and enforce standards, whether they recognize some right to them or not. I've mentioned this fact once or twice, that the real debate here is not between free speech and censorship, but between competing sets of standards grounded in competing conceptions of the good, the true, and the beautiful. I will not belabor the point. If you'd like to hear more about it, you can always get it in my book, Speechless, Controlling Words, Controlling Minds. You can order it right now on your phones if you wanted to. We could take a moment, pull up your favorite bookstore app and order it, or you could order it after the lecture. All societies have this right. So my concern here is not about any attacks on free speech with this student being arrested for making threats. My concern with this young man's arrest is not that the police have gone too far in restricting speech, but that they have not gone far enough. Because, in addition to Jews, plenty of other politically unfashionable people regularly face threats on campus, and the threat makers often face no repercussions whatsoever. Just off the top of my head, conservatives, Christians, pro-lifers, white people, even just mild critics of gender ideology, all regularly receive threats, including death threats, from political radicals. And the threats they face are not merely from fringe cranks. Top-ranking Democrat politicians have explicitly called for violence against conservatives. Congress Lady Maxine Waters has urged her followers to push back on conservatives whenever they see them in public, to go to their homes where their children sleep. Kamala Harris and top staffers for Joe Biden bailed BLM rioters who had targeted civilians out of prison. Hillary Clinton told her followers that it is impossible to be civil with Republicans. And if history has taught us anything, it is that if Hillary Clinton threatens you with violence, you take that seriously. Your life could depend on that. Okay. I'm kidding. Am I kidding? Mm-hmm. I'd bet the farm that some prominent figure at this very university has at some point proposed abolishing whiteness or some other such nonsense. It is absolutely right to punish cranks who threaten to kill innocent Jews. It is likewise right to punish the mainstream leftists who threaten all the rest of us. I myself am not Jewish. I am Catholic, so I suppose I am, in a certain sense, Jew-ish, to borrow a phrase from George Santos. We Catholics love God the Father. We love the Old Testament. We crucially took a different turn at the incarnation and crucifixion and resurrection of our Lord, and at the Pentecost and the descent of the Holy Spirit. But still, in the words of Pope Pius XI, spiritually, we are Semites. And in light of the present flashpoint for World War III, the horrific Hamas terror attack on the state of Israel, the subsequent outbreak of war in the Middle East, I cannot help but notice some additional coincidences, additional similarities between the conflict in the Middle East and the conflict Americans see on the home front every day. Immediately following the Hamas attack of October 7th, halfway across the world, the Black Lives Matter organization in the United States posted a Palestinian flag to its social media account in the silhouette of a paraglider. The meaning was clear. Not only does BLM support Palestinian civilians, it supports Hamas as well. Not only does BLM criticize certain policies of the Israeli state, as anyone might, BLM endorses the murder of more than 1,000 Israeli civilians. Women, children, and the elderly. Some were surprised that BLM would endorse Hamas. I'm not sure why. We all watched for 8 months as BLM rampaged throughout the country, burning, looting, rioting, and killing dozens of innocent people. That is who BLM is. That is what BLM does. Tactically, Hamas and BLM are on the same page. At a deeper level, the two terror groups converge ideologically as well, because the argument made by Hamas and its excusers and defenders against the State of Israel is precisely the same argument made by BLM and Antifa and other leftist groups against the United States and the West more broadly, namely that we are colonizers and settlers who are oppressing beleaguered racial and ethnic and religious minorities who have a supposedly more legitimate claim to the land. One need not blindly support the Israeli government to recognize that the arguments against the State of Israel do not bode well for us either. One need not accede to the religious and historical claims of Zionism or the wisdom of the Balfour Declaration or even the prudence of the establishment of the state in 1948 to recognize that the argument advanced against the State of Israel today is precisely the same argument advanced by many of the same people against our own country as well. One need not understand any of the nuances of this extremely complex conflict to notice that all the worst people in American politics, Rashida Tlaib, AOC, all the rest of them, all support broadly the Palestine liberation movement. One does not need a degree in political science to understand that people who tend to be wrong about everything might also be wrong about this as well. That the enemy of my enemy is often my friend. So what are we supposed to do about it? What is the American interest as we stand on the brink of World War III? The American interest, it seems to me, is not to go over the precipice. The American interest is to contain the war. To contain the war does not necessarily mean a ceasefire, as many on the left are demanding. A ceasefire in which Hamas continues to control Gaza would seem to be not only an unacceptable security risk for the State of Israel, but also, more relevant to our national concerns, a recipe for more and expanded fighting. The part that seems most relevant for us is that the recent decline of the United States and the rise of China, to quote the former and perhaps future president, raises the prospect of global war to an extremely high level. As the political scientist Graham Allison has observed, of the 16 most recent examples of a rising power confronting an established global power, war resulted in all but 4 cases. Contrary to what foreign policy geniuses like Joe Biden told us when they promoted the growth of China as a rising tide that lifts all ships, come on, Jack, come on! Corn pop, this'll raise everybody up. That is not exactly what happened. A rising tide does not always lift all boats in international relations. When a rising tide lifts a nation to challenge a great power, 75% of the time it leads to war. That is the most pressing reason that the U.S. position vis-a-vis the war in the Middle East and the war in Ukraine. You remember the war in Ukraine? That was the big story. It was always the great fight for democracy until like a week ago, and then that just totally dropped off the headlines. The other reason to contain the war is a more fundamental conservative observation. Our individual stocks of reason are small, and events can quickly spin out of control, and it's much easier to destroy than to build. American adventurism overseas has rarely worked out well for us, and over the past half century, it has been disastrous. Things have not turned out the way grandiose, self-appointed grand strategists have told us that they would. To get a sense of the complexity, consider this recent example. This is an alert that I got from my Wall Street Journal app about 3 days ago. Russia, which the left used to love but now hates, is indirectly funding Hezbollah, a theocratic terror group that you might expect the left to hate, but which it now loves, because Hezbollah attacks Israel, which the left used to support but now hates because it considers Israel a colonial extension of the West, which the left now hates and which created the modern nation state of Israel but now also hates it. Then, Israel, for its part, meanwhile, has armed Azerbaijan, which is a Muslim country carrying out a genocide of the Armenians, Armenia being the oldest Christian country in the world, even though Israel often sides with the Christians against the Muslims. But in this case, the Muslims in Azerbaijan oppose Iran, and Iran is Israel's chief enemy, and in war, the enemy of one's enemy is often one's friend. Are you confused? Join the club, man. I'm pretty confused too. The enmities and the justifications for these conflicts, Israel versus Palestine, Armenia versus Azerbaijan, Ukraine versus Russia, go back centuries, even millennia. Unless you think that you have finally solved conflicts considered intractable for decades and centuries, restraint in American war seems to be prudent. Which brings me to my broader point, a point that applies to war as well as to domestic politics, actions as well as speech. For most of history, conservatives have been the party of restraint, of limits, of humility and prudence, prudence considered by Aristotle the paramount political virtue. This reputation suffered a wee little bit of damage in the mid-2000s, thanks to the rise of the neoconservatives of the Bush era, who advocated an ambitious, downright Wilsonian foreign policy that never saw a foreign backwater that it did not want to bomb and conquer. But the aberration of the Wilsonian right has receded once again in recent years. Donald Trump, for instance, campaigned on restraint, on avoiding war, and focusing on the home front. And to the surprise of his critics, Trump conducted the finest foreign policy in at least a quarter of a century, maybe longer. I sometimes think of my relatives who I've lost, you know, who died, say, 15, 20 years ago. I think, how would I explain to them that Donald Trump, the real estate guy, the star of that reality show, the game show on NBC. Yeah, he's president. He became president, and he was great. Actually, he was like a better foreign policy president than just about. I don't think that he would not believe me, and yet it happened. If I could say Trump brought peace to the Middle East, that is a sentence you almost shouldn't be able to utter, and yet, it worked. How's that possible? Donald Trump doesn't know anything about foreign policy. I think actually that's part of the explanation. Trump's lack of foreign policy wonk bona fides seems to have served him pretty well, perhaps because he never thought that he had all the answers, and he consistently preferred modest victories to grandiose conquests. The left does not respect any such limits, moral, political, even biological. The left advances an ideology of total liberation from all constraints. Not only do they advocate liberation from the political order, they take this campaign of total revolution to its logical conclusion as they campaign for the liberation of the self from the body, which of course is impossible, through transgender ideology. And that issue fires them up more than any others. Of all the things they could attack me for, that's what they're screaming about outside this room. There is a perverse coherence to the left's false and prideful vision of the world, the nation, and even the human person, just as there is a humble consistency in the conservative vision. A line from the British political philosopher Michael Oakeshott comes to mind as relevant to you, me, and World War III. To be conservative, Oakeshott writes, is to prefer the familiar to the unknown, to prefer the tried to the untried, fact to mystery, the actual to the possible, the limited to the unbounded, the near to the distant, the sufficient to the superabundant, the convenient to the perfect, present laughter to utopian bliss. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, very kind. Now I believe we have time for questions. There is a stupid rule at the Daily Wire that says that if you disagree with me, you should be permitted to cut the line. I think you should be severely punished, but you can cut the line. And especially if that gal who I featured in my show with the Starbucks TikTok rant, I know I don't want to harp on it too much, but I would love to chat with her about how the conservatives are the party of the workers. But anyway, that probably won't happen. So if you disagree with me, cut to the front of the line. And if you agree with me, you're clearly gentlemen and ladies and scholars.
Okay, so we have now entered the Q&A session of the event. If you have a question, please move in an orderly fashion to over here by my comrade, and he will allow you to move up here. You will ask one brief question and state your name beforehand.
Leave it to the Ivy League to have this commie language here, the comrade. And, it sounds sort of like a romantic comedy, but really dark. You know, you, me, and World War III, and Dupree. Yeah.
Do I hold it? Oh, you hold it, okay. Sorry, hey, my name's Zarez. I'm a libertarian.
That's okay. That's okay. That's all right.
I know we respect I know we respect different cultures here, so I just wanted to make that clear. Something I was kind of interested in when you were talking earlier about your what's been happening recently about like the Middle East and especially on college campuses. I wanted to hear your thoughts on obviously there's speech that shouldn't be protected, like what Patrick Dye said, but about like preventing, you know, another Patriot Act or something like that to like basically censor any dissent. Well, like, what are your thoughts on protecting speech, especially in a time like this?
I think subsidiarity is really key. So one wishes to make sure that we protect our rights, our legitimate rights and our way of life and the good old American tradition. But we also want to recognize that we have not merely individual rights, but political rights. We have rights to community standards, for instance, because man is not an atomized individual floating in outer space. He's a social creature and a political animal and naturally part of a community. So I think the way that we do this is we recognize that decisions ought to be made at the most local level possible at which they can be efficiently and sufficiently determined. So what you're saying is I don't want the federal government to come in and read all of my records and suppress my speech, which they're certainly going to do anyway, but I agree it's not ideal. But the answer to that would be to say that communities are permitted to impose and enforce reasonable standards that perhaps you can't articulate the limits of on the back of a napkin in a 5-bullet-point manifesto, but which naturally come through culture and through the generations and the way that we actually live according to the lowercase c constitution rather than the uppercase c constitution, which, as we've seen, is no particular guarantor of rights because it can be abused and misinterpreted, and you can have some liberal justice on a court read invisible ink somewhere that says you've got a right to all sorts of nonsense that you don't. That would be my recommendation. And so in the same way that I don't see the free speech debate as a debate between freedom on one side and censorship on the other, so too I don't see the debate between standards and our legitimate rights as really being in conflict at all. These are things that develop naturally and organically and are, in fact, an expression of self-government, but especially when they're made on a more local level. You know, I moved from California, from Mussolini's hellscape out there, into Tennessee with the sweet air of freedom, so that not only I could pay less in taxes, not only could I have a bigger house or something, but I could live a normal life with normal people who weren't going to try to trans my kids and scream at me when I walked down the street. And so what I moved there for, in fact, was political rights. I moved there in large part for community standards. And if those sorts of standards were set at the federal level, probably that would cause a great deal of anguish and might trample on legitimate rights. As they're made more locally, everything is a bit more simpatico.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Michael. My name is Jin. I'm a liberal.
Hey, great, man.
But I'm actually a huge fan of your show, and I've listened to many hours of it.
Thank you. You're the liberal. You're the one liberal who listens to the show. No, I'm joking. I'm always so pleased when people from the left and the liberals and even the libertarians tune into the show. I really appreciate it, and I hope I can just pull you over toward my way of thinking at some point.
Sure. Maybe not. My question is not really on topic, but it's about the child tax credit. Democrats and some Republicans, like Mitt Romney, who I know you've called a squish in the past.
Great head of hair, though. You know, I compliment him where it's due.
Support a massive expansion of the child tax credit. I think it's a really good, pro-family policy, especially if you want to support the idea of people being able to afford to be single mothers, families, the American dream, living on a single income. My question, I guess, is what do you think of it, or more pointedly, as a conservative, how can you not support expanding the child tax credit?
I support a much more robust family policy. I guess where I differ from some of the Republicans who back this or that tax credit policy is I think it doesn't go nearly far enough. And that's not just an excuse to demand perfection, you know, instead of something that's perfectly serviceable. I just don't think family policy can possibly work unless it's more comprehensive. So if we presently suffer a great deal of confusion over what even a family is, it's going to be very difficult to encourage its growth. So a model that I would point to for a more robust family policy would be Hungary, which is the only country in the West that has in any way turned around the problem of a dying population and a declining birth rate. And Hungary still has a long way to go, but they've turned it around. So the population is finally stopping the bleeding. You know, they're beginning to grow a little bit more, still far away from replacement. The way that Hungary did this is by saying that if you have four kids or more, you don't have to pay taxes. That's pretty good. That's more robust than anything Mitt Romney is promising. And I think that would be great. I would fully support that here. But the other thing that Hungary has done is they've defined marriage. Then they've pointed out that in recent years, you know, we've had all sorts of crazy ideas about what marriage is. For all of human history, people thought that sexual difference had something to do with marriage. And then around 2015, a romantic poet sitting on the Supreme Court, Anthony Kennedy, he decided, no, everyone everywhere was always wrong. And actually, marriage, man, you know, it's about intimacy, man, you know, and it's about just love is love, you know, and it's about, you know, man, it's like, when you really think about it, man, what's the difference between a man and a woman? And that's all nuts, you know, so, and the people didn't support it at the time, and certain surveys now suggest that there's public support for same-sex marriage, so-called, but it's just not real. I mean, it's no offense to any of my friends who are a little light in the loafers, but if you think that men and women are different, then you have to believe that sexual difference and complementarity has something to do with marriage. And so if, you know, a family policy were then used to encourage all sorts of disordered and destructive sorts of behaviors, or the commodification of procreation, you know, the establishment of the domination of technology over the origin and destiny of human life, treating children as just, you know, no different than a handbag to be purchased, you know, as an accessory for a lifestyle that is not ordered toward that. That would be a very grave matter. So, you know, as with all policies, I would approach it with a bit of caution, and I would try not to merely treat one little symptom to the exclusion of all the others, but I would recognize that, well, at bottom, to quote Cardinal Manning, all human conflict ultimately is theological, and so we're going to have to get on the same page broadly on first principles before we're able to actually treat any of the problems. And don't think it's just pie in the sky. There is a country today in the West that has done that reasonably effectively, and we could do that too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. I am Sam. With Aquinas, with Andrew Clavin, and today you mentioned how free speech should not be absolutely free, other times putting Christianity as a very important reason for you personally. Christians should put Christ first in all ways and are called to live in a secular and fallen world. Outside of speech, there are many things that are legal but terribly sinful, such as adultery and prideful judgment. However, no one really is seeking to ban these sins as the issue of separation of church and state comes up.
Well, I'll just interrupt you for one second. Adultery has been illegal for much of American history and throughout the West broadly. So I also don't think that our nation has a firm separation of church and state as the liberals contend. I think that's a total invention of the 20th century and total nonsense. So when you say that nobody is seeking to make adultery illegal, you know, maybe some of us have suggested it.
Okay.
But sorry, go on.
With all this in mind, the one question that I want to ask you, which is also constantly asked against the leftists, and rightly so, is who gets to decide what to censor and by what standard? The church, the Bible, general prudence, you, sir?
Well, in our country, we say that we the people have the right to make these decisions, and we the people will do so through our elected representatives, ideally. We'll see if big tech gets their way, maybe not so much, but that's the way the system is set up, at least. So we make those decisions, but that doesn't really answer your question, does it? Because the next question is, well, how do we make those decisions? And the answer is that we will make those decisions based on perhaps our personal interest. We will make those decisions based upon the culture and community in which we were raised. And ultimately, we will make those decisions based on our religious views. Even if someone thinks that he is irreligious or is an atheist, it's inescapable because all law ultimately comes down to moral reasoning. Whether you're talking about the death penalty or abortion, questions that obviously so clearly come down to religious reasoning, or whether you're talking about parking tickets or tax rates, there are still going to be moral arguments about property rights or about prudence that are going to come into play there. So ultimately, that's what it's all going to come down to. And I would just as soon have people make those decisions based on solid moral reasoning rather than on the aberrant and erroneous moral reasoning that is instilled in them from the age of 3 these days all the way up through college and graduate school, which is not conducive to their own individual flourishing or to society's flourishing. So who decides? We do. And if in your question there is a hint of trepidation to say that perhaps one can never really know what is good or what is true or what is beautiful, maybe not you, you're a smart young man, but some people have raised that issue. Well, if we can't discern those things, if we, with what reason we have and moral conscience that we have, cannot discern the difference between those things, then we just have to hang up self-government. Nobody's going to come in and save us in our political situation. We can pray for a savior, ultimately, and we have a savior, actually, ultimately, but in our current setup of self-government, it's up to us. So you can't evade the question. You've got to come up with the reasoning yourself, and you better hope you're right, because either way, in a government, you are going to be imposing certain views on other people. So, you know, do it with your full chest, do it with confidence, use your brain, train your will to be disciplined and not vicious, and have a virtuous society, which is a prerequisite for constitutional government, as our founding fathers and the framers of the constitutions of the Constitution told us in explicit terms.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Hello. Following in the route of the previous speakers, I'll start out with my political affiliation. I would say that I do lean somewhat liberal, but being raised in Texas, I have had to consider each of my opinions carefully and thoughtfully, so I would identify as independent.
If you're a liberal from Texas, you're probably more right-wing than I am, you know, so that's great. I'm glad to hear it.
Right. So my question follows up on the previous question, which is, you said that you believe in the will of the people.
I said that that's the system that we're currently operating under.
All right. Then I have a question about your opinions for this system. If, say, for example, the majority of people were supporting something such as gay marriage, which I believe, according to Gallup recently, was 71% of people, or, for example, transgender healthcare, would you support the system as it exists to allow these rights to be created, or would you seek to change this system to stop this from happening?
No, I'm a Catholic, so I think error has no rights, ultimately. And I do not believe, as some have suggested, that vox populi is vox Dei, that the voice of the people is the voice of God. In fact, that phrase, which is now used positively, was formerly a joke. I mean, it was a warning against this insanity of mob rule. In fact, our founding fathers, who created our system of government, warned against that very fact, and the warnings against mob rule pervade the entire Federalist Papers. Though our system of government is often described as a democracy, or in recent decades, a liberal democracy. Curious how the liberals, you know, added that modifier to the term. But that's not really what it is. You know, in fact, I think if you go back and read St. Thomas Aquinas in the Summa Theologiae, you will notice a fair degree of similarity between his ideal political system and our own system of government as it was created. And I suspect that the founders and the framers were familiar, at least indirectly, with St. Thomas's writings. And for St. Thomas, the ideal government has a monarchical element, which we have in the executive, we have that in the presidency, and it would have an aristocratic element, which we have not only in the Senate, but in the representation of other interests in the United States, and then it has a healthy democratic component to a representation of the people, which obviously we have in the United States. So there is some balance here, and it's comprehensive of all of those interests in society. And part of the reason that we have those constraints in our system of government is because the people sometimes get it wrong. Now, in the case of so-called same-sex marriage, that actually was not the people getting it wrong. The people were consistently against that redefinition because it's nonsensical. The Supreme Court had to impose that from above. And as with many things, when there are impositions made by the political order, that does change minds. I know conservatives are fond of saying that culture is politics is downstream of culture, which is true enough in many circumstances. But politics, the law, is also a teacher and can shape the culture as well and have extraordinary influence on the culture. And that's what happened in the case of same-sex marriage. If the court came down tomorrow and said, no, actually, we got that one wrong. Turns out boys and girls are different. Sorry, you know, taking an audible on that. I suspect within 5 years or so, public opinion would return to what it normally has been. So no, I don't think that the people are the voice of God and they can get it wrong, which is why it's very, very important to protect the just and prudent limits that have been placed on the people so that we don't descend into mob rule by our very wise founding fathers.
So in that scenario, if we have the world as it is today and this does not get repealed, would you change the system at all in order to ensure that the voice of the people is not the voice of the law?
I would try to restore some of the early constraints that were placed on what could potentially descend into mob rule. This has been a very long story that's gone on over time, so I'm not going to point to just one issue or another and say, that was it, that was where we went off the rails. Actually, I will. The 17th Amendment was not great, you know, because the 17th Amendment took away the right of states to have legitimate representation for those political communities. So the direct election of senators took away a very important constraint on the people. And there have been many other such problems throughout American history. So I would prudently and gradually attempt to restore some of those protections because I think that the founding fathers and the framers, for all their flaws, they're not demigods, they weren't perfect, but I think they were much wiser than a lot of the so-called reformers throughout the 19th and 20th centuries.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. Good questions.
Hello. Good evening. She's a liberal from Texas. I'm a liberal from Pittsburgh, so I don't know
from
what that
Pittsburgh?
Means. Yeah.
Did I see you with a Molotov cocktail? So, no.
My friends did tell me about that, though. My question is revolving on foreign policy. You mentioned that Trump's foreign policy you consider to be one of the best in the last 25 years. I take issue with this because he abandoned many of our alliances abroad. He made it very challenging for the United States to embrace collective deterrence, and likely right now would not fund a war in Ukraine that deters authoritarian nations from using military violence as a means of expanding their borders. As a last point, he also isolated many of our neighbors economically by imposing tariffs on them, oftentimes without consulting them.
You mean in the Americas, or you mean overseas?
No, in Canada or Europe. Let's use those examples, right? So I was wondering if you see any value in embracing alliances or in using trade agreements as a means of advancing America's stability and ability to project power abroad?
Well, I certainly do believe in alliances, strategic alliances, not tethering ourselves permanently to some other country like that. And I obviously believe in trade deals, but I guess I would break with the liberals and with the free trader conservatives who are pretty liberal themselves of the 90s and 2000s and suggest that it's not necessarily a great idea to offshore all of your jobs and have all of your goods manufactured in another country. That was the argument from the free traders, was that a rising tide lifts all ships and we can get really cheap stuff from China, and yeah, they steal our IP, and yeah, they cheat on World Trade Organization treaties, but hey, no big deal, how could that ever come back to bite us? And now we're on the brink of World War III in large part because of the growth of China and because of what Graham Allison called the Thucydides trap. So, I'm not entirely opposed to tariffs. The Republican Party was founded on tariffs. Our great Republican presidents all imposed tariffs. Ronald Reagan, though he's been revised in history as a total free trader, imposed significant tariffs. And so Trump is running on that as well. I think that's probably a good idea. In terms of standing up for our allies, you know, right now the present administration has largely abandoned Israel, has funded Israel's chief enemy, Iran, has just said that he will not sign a defense bill for Israel, which faces an existential threat, a second war of independence, according to Bibi Netanyahu. Biden has said he won't do that if the bill doesn't also include Ukraine funding. Donald Trump did not take that approach. Donald Trump stood firmly with Israel, so much so that they named a town after him. I always thought it was so funny when people called the man an anti-Semite. There's no David Duke town in Israel, you know? There's no, I think they named a train station after Trump, too. So if he's an anti-Semite, he's the worst anti-Semite in American history. And what he was able to do is, by forging, not only defending old alliances, but forging new ones, President Trump was able to sign the Abraham Accords, which gave relative peace to the Middle East and stability until the current president threw it all down the can for no reason. So yes, I support all of those things, but it ought to be done with regard to the American national interest. And I think that in the fever pitch of the post-Cold War utopian end of history, America will be a global hegemon forever, we lost sight of that, and so we fell into conflicts and into trade agreements that were not to our national advantage, and that have led us to the brink of not only impoverishment, but of potentially a global conflict with a rising power like China. So I suppose I would entirely reject your view of Trump's foreign policy and say the man, for all of his flaws, he wasn't without missteps, but his foreign policy was very good, and it was good in particular because of its unpredictability, because it didn't just follow a script. So one day, he sounds like the biggest dove, he's never gonna go to war, give peace a chance, man. The next day, he's dropping the Moab, or he's assassinating the top Iranian general. But then he goes back in and he refuses to strike on other military targets. So because of that, you know, that's the sort of thing that keeps the little man in North Korea at bay. When this maniac with blonde hair says, I've got a big nuclear button too and my button works. And it's also what prevented Vladimir Putin from further invading Ukraine. For the last 23 years now, I guess for the last, four presidencies, Vladimir Putin has invaded a sovereign nation, or at least further invaded a sovereign nation, for every one of those presidencies except for Trump. So, you know, for all the talk of Russia collusion, it would seem to me that Trump even managed to keep Putin at bay. And I hope he has a chance to do it again.
Thank you.
Okay, everyone, we have time for one more question here.
No, only one. I want to be here all night.
Only
and then
one.
I want to talk to the people outside, but that's okay. I follow the rules.
Well, I'll try and take as much of your time as I can.
Great,
so.
Great.
Hi, my name's Alex. I'm an independent from DC. I watched your talk from about a month ago at Georgetown University, where you compared Joe Biden and Xi Jinping, as well as Vladimir Putin, yep. And you asserted that Joe Biden was as bad, or perhaps even a worse leader than Xi Jinping. And I was really hoping to get a little bit of clarification on your stance regarding that.
Sure.
So in
I
your
stand
talk,
by it. That's my stance. That's my clarification. In case some people said, surely Michael was joking or he was misinterpreted. I was not misinterpreted. I said exactly what I mean, and I stand by it.
Great. I remember that in your talk, you argued that abortions being legal in some parts of the U.S. and not being banned at a federal level is comparable to the forced abortions and sterilizations carried out against the Uyghur religious minority in China.
Well, what I said was comparable was the forced sterilizations right. That are occurring against young people in America through the promotion of transgender ideology all the way up to the White House.
Yep. Right. I guess I was just a little bit curious because in particular with like Xi Jinping and the Chinese communists in particular in this situation, they stand at the forefront of this decades-long campaign of forced sterilizations, of forced abortions, and genocide against Chinese citizens both within and without this specific minority. My family, personally, was tortured and murdered at the hands of the Chinese Communist Party. They fled about 70-some years ago. I had
so this was a little before Chairman Xi.
No, yeah, indeed. Yep. But the fact remains that Xi Jinping was active in the Communist Party at this time. He still promotes the same ideologies that underpinned the actions that were taken against millions of...
I'm not sure he does. I mean, I'm very sorry to hear about your family's suffering, and I hate the Chinese Communist Party. Mm-hmm. My point with someone like Chairman Xi is to one, instill a little healthy dose of humility in the United States and open our eyes to some of the horrors that we're committing. For instance, killing 800,000 babies a year and sterilizing and chopping up little kids and reducing their life expectancy and giving them osteoporosis and all other complications based on this ridiculous ideology that men can become women and vice versa. Mm-hmm. When it comes to Xi, I'm not in any way defending Chairman Xi or Vladimir Putin either for that matter, but the fact that Chairman Xi now has been working more against abortion than the Chinese Communist Party ever had in the past, obviously when they had the one-child policy and were forcing abortions not only on the Uyghur minority or other oppressed groups, but on the entire country, that's a turn in the right direction. The fact that Chairman Xi has supported the liberalization of parts of the economy when the Chinese Communist Party did not do such things, but with an eye toward cultural preservation, to me is something not to be emulated exactly, because China's a very different country, but it's something to take note of, because in the United States, unfortunately, the policies of our president seem to be strongly against the national interest. I mean, you talk about the horrors that have taken place against minorities in places like Russia to some degree, but especially in China. But consider the fact that in New York City, more black babies are killed in the womb than are born. The most dangerous place for a black person in the city of New York is in his mother's womb. And this is not merely some pathology of the black community or some random city. This is a policy that is actively pushed by our government and by the leader of the country. And that's a very, very evil thing. And it's especially evil because Xi Jinping is a communist. The man, we don't expect anything from him. Joe Biden purports to be Catholic, and yet he violates some of the most sacred teachings and obligations of his church on a daily basis and leads to all sorts of scandal. That is a terribly evil, evil thing.
Thank you. And I appreciate you kind of clarifying your position on that. But I just think, coming away from that talk, I was just a bit struck that it almost seemed as though you were, drawing like a parallel between, abortion with the consent of the mother, which I'm pro-choice, but I do believe that pro-life and pro-choice, you can agree that that's worse, that forced abortion is worse than that.
No, I think they both murder a child, and that's just terribly evil in both cases.
Indeed,
and I don't think that a child whose mother chooses to kill him is worth any less than a child whose mother does not choose to kill him. I think it's just murder in both cases, and I don't think one life is more valuable than the other.
I guess just the one thing I was kind of curious about was... All right. Well, thank you.
I take it. Can I know?
All right. Yeah.
I hear the right. Yeah.
One last thing I was just a little bit curious about was, in general, just coming away from the talk, I was struck a little bit by the idea that, yes, I understand there's very many legitimate criticisms and you make some valid points, but at the end of the day, I feel like that's not necessarily enough to, specifically condemn Joe Biden as being worse or a worse leader than someone who actively chooses to perpetrate genocidal actions against religious minorities. Moreover, I was struck by a tweet that you'd put out around the same time, I believe, where you said, quote, "I am beginning to suspect that Joe Biden is a more evil ruler than either Vladimir Putin or Xi Jinping."
Yeah.
I guess the one thing I was kind of a little bit curious about is you are a person with influence. You have a show.
Stop it. Go on. I'm not that handsome. Get out of here.
You've got two books.
Cut it
You've
out.
Written one.
That's right.
I just wanted to say thank you. I really appreciate the chance to kind of discuss this with you and just make sure that, in general, your opinions are not misconstrued as something that is perhaps a bit more extreme.
My pleasure. I really am not a bomb thrower. I mean, I guess we're all bomb throwers a little bit in politics, but I don't say things just to get a reaction from people. I try to express my views in a way that is proportionate to the meaning. And so I considered that when I wrote my speech and wrote my tweet and continue to defend that position today, which is that I understand how many people can be blinded by the evils that are, and not just the persistent evils of history that go along with every country, but the novel evils that are being promoted by our extraordinarily corrupt rulers right now in the United States. But that is why I think it's so important to turn our eyes toward them. When I was reacting to President Biden, it was in large part because Joe Biden was not only infiltrating Catholic churches to spy his FBI to spy on just ordinary Christians who he compared to terrorists, not only to go and persecute mothers and fathers for standing up for their children's rights to have an education and not be groomed into bizarre sexual ideologies. They were called domestic extremists. They were compared to terrorists. But specifically, the specific incident that raised my ire was that Joe Biden sent his thugs to go arrest 8 pro-life leaders, I think a 9th has now been indicted, who exposed illegal abortions taking place. I think all abortions should be illegal, but these were already illegal abortions, partial birth abortions, abortions well past the legal limit, of babies being tortured, left to die on a table by a man named Cesare Santangelo, who was caught on camera admitting to this, and some heroic pro-lifers, some of whom are conservative, some of whom are leftists, some of whom are Christians, some of whom are Jewish, some of whom don't say they don't have any religion at all. They went to shed light on this, to peacefully demonstrate at an abortion clinic. They were rounded up, they were arrested, they're being thrown in the can, they face 11 years, including a woman of a certain age, Joan Bell, who is a saint on earth, and Joe Biden, that psycho, is at this point sending her to die in prison. For what? For standing up to shed some light on illegal abortions taking place on babies who are fully formed, who were photographed. We've seen them with our own eyes, if we can bear even to look at it. To say nothing of the intentional dismantling of the family, to say nothing of the intentional sterilization of children, the butchery, the scientific experiments being carried out on kids with Joe Biden's explicit encouragement. That is evil. That is so profoundly evil. And we don't want to admit it because the evil regimes have to be overseas and they have to be the big bad men like Xi Jinping or Vladimir Putin. But if we won't open our eyes and acknowledge the evil within our own shores, we'll never do anything to fix it. And so I don't think there's any hyperbole there at all. If anything, I think the reason that there was some consternation from my speech was because people have buried their heads in the sand at a fact too ghastly to acknowledge.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, that's our show on that happy note. Wonderful to be with you all. Thank you so much for having me. No more questions. You're not going to let me take any more. Okay, that's it. I'm out of here. Thank you so much. If I have any interactions with my friends outside, we'll be sure to live stream them so you can catch the rest of the Q&A. Thank you very much.